People take a lot for granted. Feeling the sensation of your partner gripping your hand or a hug from a loved one may not seem all that significant on an everyday basis, but could you imagine what your life would be like if you couldn't feel those sensations at all? For many people around the world, it's impossible for them to feel touch. It may be due to a number of causes, including amputation, paralysis, or motor degenerative diseases like ALS or muscular dystrophy. Fortunately, neurotechnology may provide hope to stimulate those sensations again. In 2016, Nathan Copeland, who is paralyzed, was able to, with the use of a robotic arm, feel the sense of touch again. This incredible feat was made possible through the use of invasive neurotechnology. Every type of neurotechnology has a different degree of invasiveness. Some devices don't even need to touch the skin, whereas others must be implanted deep beneath the outer layers covering the brain or spinal cord. Hi, I'm Colin Fosnot, and today we're going to discuss invasive neurotechnology. When we discuss the field of brain-computer interfacing, we're generally referring to central nervous system, or CNS, approaches. CNS approaches will generally be either applied at the surface of the brain or through electrodes which are implanted into the tissue of the brain. In general, these devices, particularly those in the brain, pose the greatest risk to the user when compared to other neurotechnologies. If an implanted device is rejected by the body, the area of the brain may scar, which makes it more difficult to read data from. There are also higher risks of damage to the brain with invasive neurotechnology, which could cause complications. For example, if major damage occurs to the motor regions of the brain, that damage could result in loss of function in the body, like paralysis. Invasive neurotechnologies tend to provide higher specificity and precision of targeting and better signal-to-noise ratios than their non-invasive counterparts. That being said, misuse and abuse of invasive neurotechnologies can pose larger risks compared to non-invasive approaches, but both have the potential for abuse. Recent publications have suggested that many wireless medical devices and other implanted devices have significant security flaws, either due to their ability to be forced into a state of inactivity or hacked and abused by third parties. Both invasive and non-invasive neurotechnologies are able to significantly influence human behavior, and it's very important that proper security measures are taken when these devices are created to avoid any malicious party from causing serious harm. Within invasive neurotechnologies, there are generally two types of interfaces, peripheral and central nervous system interfaces. We will start with the peripheral nerve interfaces, or PNS. PNS interfaces can be, broadly, split into the following four major categories: epineural and extraneural interfaces, electrodes on the outer layer of the nerve or outside of the nerve; penetrating interfaces, electrodes that are piercing the nerve or inserted deeper into the nerve; regenerative interfaces, which grow into the nerve using bioactive materials; and hybrids, which combine elements of two or more of these and don't necessarily fit into any category. We won't cover all of the possible approaches, but we will introduce you to a few examples of each type. Let's start by discussing epineural and extraneural interfaces, otherwise known as non-penetrating interfaces. Three commonly used electrodes for non-penetrating interfaces are paddle electrodes, the cylindrical nerve cuff, and the flat interface nerve electrode, or fine electrode. Paddle electrodes are generally a long flat surface with some number of electrodes embedded into one side. These electrodes are particularly prone to migration, meaning the electrodes sometimes move throughout the body from the place where they were originally implanted. Despite this issue, paddle electrodes remain a relatively common tool in neuromodulation for chronic pain and are even sold commercially by several different vendors with varying capabilities and settings. One somewhat more precise approach is the cylindrical nerve cuff. These work similarly to paddle electrodes in that they mostly consist of a surface with embedded electrodes. These devices generally wrap around the outside of a nerve. Unlike the paddle electrodes, which can have as much as 75% loss in effectiveness over a 7-year period, most patients with cuff electrodes experience significantly lower rates of effectiveness reduction. Because of these advances over paddle electrodes, cuff interfaces are useful for long-term implants of motor and sensory neuroprostheses. Fine electrodes and composite fine electrodes use flattening of the nerve to improve electrode signal quality. These technologies have been applied to many areas, such as pain suppression, respiration, bladder control, epilepsy, motor system interfaces, and sensory interfaces for prosthetics. There have been numerous experiments showing their effectiveness, but they're rarely used in practice. Our next category is penetrating PNS interfaces. This includes devices like the Utah Electrode Array, Microelectrode Arrays, or MEAs, longitudinal intravascular electrodes, or LIFE electrodes, and transverse intravascular multi-channel electrodes, or TIME electrodes. Microelectrode arrays are generally blocks with several extending spikes of electrodes on the end, and are intended for more localized stimulation and recording of the peripheral nerves. LIFE electrodes are inserted along the length of the peripheral nerve, where the nerve is cut or lost. Finally, TIME electrodes are inserted through the nerve to access deeper nerve fascicles. A third option for invasive interfaces are regenerative peripheral nerve interfaces, or RPNIs. These interfaces prevent growth of painful neuromas in the peripheral nerves commonly located in the stumps of amputee extremities. Neuromas are a painful condition, sometimes referred to as a pinched nerve, which are common in amputees. Residual nerves left over from before an amputation are given a site to innervate in muscle grafts harvested from the residual limb's remaining tissue. Basically, surgeons take muscle tissue from another area of the amputated site and give nerves a place to connect to. RPNIs have also been shown to be able to reduce phantom limb pain. Many other peripheral nervous system interfaces have similarly helped to reduce or eliminate amputee phantom pain. These devices provide to the nerve a site to innervate and subsequently allow researchers to interface with this nerve in new ways. By performing invasive electromyography on the reinnervated muscle interfaces, these RPNIs can be used to control neuroprosthetic limbs and can be used to decode information transmitted on the motor fibers in the residual nerve. Another approach that is very similar to RPNIs and is also used to reduce neuromas and control prosthetics is called targeted muscle reinnervation. TMR works by implanting nerves into a patient's existing muscles at specific target locations rather than using muscle grafts. There are also invasive neural interfaces which target the central nervous system, which, as a reminder, include the brain and spinal cord. Some of the most well-known techniques used for invasive central nervous system devices are electrocorticography, or ECoG, which uses flat surface electrodes on the surface of the brain, microelectrode array-based stimulation, and deep brain stimulation, or DBS, which uses depth electrodes to penetrate and stimulate deeper areas beneath the cortical surface. There are a few experimental devices that are being developed and show promise for making it easier to receive an implant. An experimental device pioneered by the company Synchron, called the Stentrode, is inserted into the brain without the need for brain surgery. This is accomplished by pushing an electrode carefully through brain vasculature, starting in the neck until it reaches the motor cortex. Once at its target, the electrode array expands into the blood vessel so that it doesn't restrict blood flow and is accepted into the body. The signal quality isn't as good as a microelectrode array, but it's pretty darn good when you consider that you don't have to undergo brain surgery. There are also new techniques in development, like Neuralink's neural lace, which is sewn into the brain's cortical surface, wherein they provide stimulation and recording. These aforementioned technologies have been applied across a broad spectrum of application areas, from cochlear implants, which are inserted into the cochlea to stimulate the nerve, to those implanted on the brain itself to restore function. Retinal implants have also been developed for the creation of artificial eyes and communicate with the occipital cortex to restore sight. These penetrating approaches are good for picking up signals from deeper regions of the brain, but suffer from risks of damage to the neurons. They have improved signal-to-noise ratio over non-invasive approaches, reduced crosstalk from other neurons, and are more sensitive because they are closer to their sites of interest. Long-term penetrating approaches suffer from higher probabilities of tissue injury and scarring, partially due to their use of materials more rigid than the nerves they're interacting with. These approaches are more common in the central nervous system, as the brain experiences much less movement within its surrounding tissues than in peripheral nerves. In this video, we discuss the different types of peripheral and central nervous system invasive brain-computer interfaces. In our next video, Harrison will give a broad overview of non-invasive neurotechnology and discuss how they differ from invasive approaches.